today we are going to continue our series on mathematical problem solving by looking at game theory. There will be 5 videos on game theory focusing on 2 different techniques. The mathematical study of games only really developed as a separate area of maths in the first half of the 20th century, which is quite recent. One of the most well-known people to study game theory was John Nash, who developed and applied game theory to economics, winning him a Nobel Prize. Game theory turns out to be tremendously useful across a lot of subjects, including biology, economics, and social science. In these videos, we're going to be looking at a very special class of games. They will be for exactly 2 players and won't involve any randomness, so no dice or packs of cards. Both players will have full knowledge about the game at all times, so this rules out things like auctions, where you don't know how high your opponent is willing to bid. Okay, maybe not what you might normally call a game. We also want our games to end, either with a win for one of the players or in a draw. For any game which satisfies these conditions, then either the first player has a strategy that guarantees they will win whatever player 2 does, or the second player has such a winning strategy, or both players can force at least a draw. These constraints limit the games that we can look at, but they will allow us to analyse the games mathematically. Even with these constraints, you can get some extremely complex games. For example, both chess and Go satisfy all of our requirements, but there's no hope of ever coming up with a winning strategy for either game. For all of the games that we look at, it will be a good idea to employ our first general problem-solving technique, so you should have a go at playing them yourself to get a feel for how they work. Maybe convince a sibling or housemate to play them with you, or failing that, perhaps the family pet. If possible, I will put a link in the description of each of the videos to where you can play the games online. In this video, we are going to focus on a technique for studying games called position analysis. By a position in a game, I just mean a possible state of the game. This could mean the layout of pieces on a chessboard, for example. Suppose player 1 has a winning strategy in a game. Then there will be some positions from which either player 1 can win on their next turn, or player 2 can lose on their next turn. We call these winning or losing positions, respectively. Suppose there are some losing positions. We can then work backwards through the game. If there is a position from which player 1 can move to put their opponent in one of those losing positions, then we call that position a winning position, and the move a winning move. Working backwards again, if there is a position from which player 2 can only move to leave player 1 in one of those winning positions, then player 2 will lose from that position on their next turn. Therefore, this position is a losing position. To be a losing position, player 1 must be able to go on to win whatever player 2 chooses to do. Repeating this process, we can build up a list of winning and losing positions in the game. If the opening position of the game is a winning position, then player 1 can always move to leave player 2 in a losing position, and this is a strategy for them to win the game. If, on the other hand, the game starts in a losing position, player 1 must leave player 2 in a winning position, from where they can go on to win. If neither of these things happen, both players can force a draw by avoiding winning and losing positions. This proves, by the way, my earlier claim that there will always be either a winning strategy or a strategy to force at least a draw. Minus a few details, which I'll leave up to you to put in the comments. Let's try doing this for the game of 21 Dares, which I talked about at the end of last video. Just as a quick reminder, 2 players must count up to 21, taking it in turns to say the next 1, 2, or 3 numbers. The loser is the person who says 21. We want to know whether either player has a winning strategy, and if so, what that strategy is. Well, it's not possible to draw this game, so one of the players must have a winning strategy. First, we should ask ourselves what the positions are in this game. The positions are just the numbers from 0 to 20, which we can interpret as the number the other player finished on at the end of the previous turn. Or, in other words, It is the state of the game at the start of a player's turn. So if player 2 just counted 5-6, for example, player 1 is now in position 6 and can count up to 7, 8 or 9. Position 0 is the starting position because neither player has said any numbers, and player 1 can leave player 2 in positions 1, 2 or 3. What are the losing positions for 21 dares then? Well, there's only one final losing position, position 20. If either player ends up in position 20, they must say 21 on their next turn and lose. Working backwards, we can see that positions 17, 18 and 19 are all winning positions because the player in these positions can count up 3, 2 or 1 numbers and leave their opponent in the losing position. Next, notice that position 16 is a losing position because if a player is in this position, they must count up to 17, 18 or 19 and so leave their opponent in a winning position. Hopefully you can see that this pattern will continue, so we can label all of the positions as either winning or losing. Doing this, you can see that the starting position, position 0, is a losing position. This means that player 2 has the winning strategy. Whatever player 1 does, player 2 should count up to the next losing position, 4, 8, 12, 16 or 20. On player 1's first turn, they must count to either 1, 2 or 3, and then player 2 can count to 4. On player 1's second turn, they must count to 5, 6 or 7, and then player 2 can count up to 8, and so on. Notice that player 2 just has to aim for the multiples of 4, 4 being one more than 3, which is how much the players can count each turn. What if, instead of 21 dares, we played 22 dares, or 395 dares? Well, we could do the same process again, and sometimes the starting position will be a losing position, and so player 2 will still have the same winning strategy, aim for multiples of 4. But in fact, most of the time, the starting position won't be a losing position, and so player 1 will have the winning strategy. They won't be aiming for multiples of 4, but instead for all numbers with the same remainder when divided by 4. For 22 dares, this remainder is 1, and for 395 dares, this remainder is 2. What then about the general version of the game, where the players have to count up to P in steps of up to Q? Well, I'll leave it up to you to fill the details in the comments if you want, but the same sort of thing happens. The winning strategy is to aim for the numbers which have the same remainder when divided by Q plus 1. If P is 1 more than a multiple of Q plus 1, then position 0 is a losing position and player 2 can follow this strategy and win. Otherwise, player 1 has the winning strategy. Thinking back to our general problem-solving techniques, position analysis is just a reincarnation of working backwards. We are also using the other techniques here and there as we apply the strategy. I'm going to give you two more games to think about where doing position analysis in this way can be very useful. Picking up sticks. Start with a pile of 31 sticks. Two players take it in turns to remove up to half of the sticks. So on the first turn, the first player can take between 1 and 15 sticks. The player who can't take any sticks, that is to say, the player who is left with a pile of just one stick on their turn, loses. Which player has a winning strategy? What about if you start off with a pile of K sticks? Who has the winning strategy then? Wythoff's game. This game is played on a standard 8x8 chessboard with a single queen. The first player places the queen anywhere in the top row of the board, and then, with the other player moving next, each player takes it in turns to move the queen any number of squares to the left, down, or diagonally left and down. The player who moves the queen into the bottom left square loses. In which square should the first player place the queen, and what strategy should they employ to win? Notice that it's not possible to draw either of these games, so we know from the constraints on the types of games we're looking at that exactly one of the players in each case must have a winning strategy. That's it for this video. Don't forget to put your ideas and solutions in the comments. As a warning, both of the games I've introduced in this video, and indeed all of the games I'm going to talk about in this series, are well known and well studied. You can easily find the answers to my questions online. But remember, the main idea of these videos is not to understand the games themselves, or even really game theory in general, but mathematical problem solving. So I highly recommend trying these problems on your own. As usual, I shall talk about the solutions to both problems in the next video. Subscribe to be notified about that video, and thanks for watching.